And lastly, and the fourth speaker will be Dr. Recep Yaldiz, a staff scientist at SABIC in Netherlands. Will be delivering his talk on the mass scale production of composites via automation and digitalization.
Good afternoon. Welcome to this session on mass scale production of composites via automation and digitalization. Although SABIC will be known for most of the people here, let me quickly introduce SABIC for the ones who are not familiar with. If the computer allows me to go to the next slide. Yes. SABIC was established in 1976 in Saudi Arabia and did grow to a global chemical company with operations in 50 countries by now and 68 world-class plants worldwide. SABIC is offering material solutions to customers from a wide range of industry segments. And in order to get thermoplastic composites, as shown here, really gain adoption by the industry, we need to make sure we are covering the whole value chain, add all the pieces here, and don't leave anything behind. As said, SABIC is a material supplier, but it is committed to work with everybody in the value chain. For example, we have close cooperation with tier ones and tier twos. And similarly, you can see on this slide, our activities fields we get involved for thermoplastic composites is covering the whole value chain. We believe at SABIC that it is not sufficient to only provide best-in-class materials and we adopt concrete engineering principles in order to capture the full value proposition. This brings us to the so-called trifecta approach, which means a strong interplay between material forms, processing, and clever design. In the remainder of my presentation, I would like to focus the attention on the one aspect in the middle of the trifecta, namely the mass manufacturability of thermoplastic composites, which is largely a challenge for adoption of these materials by industry. Thermoplastic composites are increasingly being considered for mass production applications, like the consumer electronics, as shown here, a tablet cover. It could be also a laptop cover, ABCD covers of laptops, or mobile phones. However, the current industry status shows still too much manual operation, low level of integration along the value chain, low process digitalization and adaptiveness. Well, this is making the mass production not possible, of course, and this must change. But there are certain challenges also on this way, like reaching the consistent high quality. It's quite difficult, but also you need to secure a cycle time that is suitable for mass production. It should be around 1 minute or lower than 1 minute. On the other hand, you also want to have as low as possible conversion cost, otherwise it will be too expensive simply. Also, the flexibility of the line is important for production goals. You don't want to put a lot of investment in one system and it is not flexible to go to be applied for anything else. So these challenges are not easy and they require material and process related solutions. On the material side, unidirectional continuous fiber reinforced thermoplastics show up as a major route for mass manufacturing and that will be addressed in this session as an example. For the demonstration purposes, we use here UDMX carbon fiber filled tapes from company FRT Tapes. These materials are offering different advantages, of course, like the superior and physical properties at lightweight, of course, and high specific stiffness compared to thermosets. Also faster processing compared to thermosets and more versatile in processing. And finally, also the recyclability, which is important for the sustainability aspect. Now you see on the right side a typical cross section of such a tape, and you can see, for example, fibers that are embedded in a thermoplastic resin matrix. Typically, these tapes are made by spreading fiber tows and embedding them into a thermoplastic resin matrix. Making a good quality unidirectional tape requires then also a good spreading and good impregnation of the fiber bundles into the resin matrix. And this process dominated by Darcy's law, I will not go into the depth of the modeling here, as there are already quite some experts in this field who will be able to tell much more than I do here. The key message that I want to give here is that from the perspective of materials and process, SABIC can tailor the formulations of its resins for easy impregnation, for example. A good example could be a reduction of the viscosity by playing with the ingredients of the formulation. As a next step, the tape material goes through a lamination process to make laminates. And then the consolidation process is the key step that influences the production speed, conversion cost, and final laminate quality, or in other words, yield. Now, mastering the consolidation process is important for mass manufacturing, of course. In addition, having the modeling capability of this consolidation process enables the digitalization and better understanding of the whole process. However, we need to secure accuracy of our predictive models, of course. And this requires comprehensive validation efforts. And we have developed also a consolidation model, and our consolidation model is extensively validated on glass polypropylene tapes. This model enables us to determine the processing window. And it also helps us to optimize the process parameters. And if there are any issues, it helps us also to understand better what is the cause of this problem. And in that respect, such validated models are crucial for a digital twin of the mass manufacturing process. So that about the process. So far we have been talking about focusing on materials and process related aspects. Now for a mass manufacturing, we also need, of course, some automation of the process for mass manufacturing. And in order to demonstrate that capability for thermoplastic composites, SABIC has implemented a demo line, which we have called Digital Composites Manufacturing Line, with partners Airborne and Siemens. This line targeted mass manufacturing of laminates as shown on the picture here. Now, in this case, our design philosophy was to design and build a line that converts UD tape material to a consolidated product with minimum human intervention and scrap. This is a significant target, of course. Now, we followed, and besides this, a logistics-based modular design approach and tried to maximize the line flexibility. Also tried to maximize the use of off-the-shelf technologies to minimize the risk of new technologies. Further, we targeted 100% inspection of the incoming and outgoing products to enable us understand the causes of potential scrap that we will be producing. Finally, it's of course a must-have is that we try to minimize the conversion costs and cycle time for mass manufacturing. Now, let me show you some details of the line we have implemented. Here in this slide, we are zooming into the front end of the line, which we have implemented, where we see the rolls of tape being uncoiled at the left side and inspected for quality. So the tape coming out from the uncoiler, they go through a tape inspection station first, and the pieces of tape are all checked for being in specs or not. Now, pieces of tape with defects like, for example, the size metrics, this is not okay or not in the tolerance, or the width is not in the tolerance, or we can talk about surface issues like dry spots or contaminations. Now, these defects are need to be checked. And if piece of tape with defects, such defects are captured, they are discarded automatically for recycling. Now, if the tape is passing the specs, then it is fed into a flexible logistic transport and layup system, as you can see here with loops with some trays on it. Now, this system is, in fact, based on trays that are running over the feeder system, or the transport system, where the layup is created by feeding pre-cut tape layers or sheets, as we call, into these trays at the feeder locations. And at each feeder station, we feed one or two layers or multiple layers of sheets, typically with different orientation, fiber orientation, or different material. It can be a thermoplastic film, or it can be a fabric or something else. And in this case, the trays are running, circulating around those feeders until they get the full layup. The system is checking that and tracking that fully automatically. Once the layup is ready, then they go to the tacking welding station where they are welded together. And after that, the layup is again checked for quality issues at layup level, like the size matrix again, and if the quality of the welding is sufficient. Well, if the layup is not okay, then it goes to a quarantine. If it is meeting the passing the quality metrics, then it goes to the next stage. As such, I think this system will be very similar for you to a system that you will recognize from the airports for the baggage handling systems. Now, this is very similar to that. And well, if the layups are ready, then we go to the next station. They are fed into a consolidation station by the loading robot. After the consolidation, we get, in fact, laminates out of this station. And those laminates are offloaded by another robot and transferred to other robots for further inspection station. The robots are again taking care for multi-step laminate finishing and quality inspections efforts. Well, quality, we talk again about size and surface kind of defects. For example, it can be contamination, it can be surface roughness, it can be thickness, width mismatches. So, and what happens is also in this station is that we also have added for the demonstration purposes a finishing stage. where we are trimming the multiple edges of the laminate in a stepwise approach. The laminate quality is then also checked before and after each of these finishing operations. Now, if the laminates do not meet the quality metrics, it is rejected and placed in the red recycling repair box. Of course, the most of the laminates need to go to the green box, depending on the quality metrics that we are defining. Now, this is in fact kind of summarizing what happens. In addition, the inspection system at the front end and at the back end, for the incoming and outgoing products, they could be connected to each other for backward and forward integration. And in addition to that, they could be connected to a digital twin of the process to make the process adaptive and self-learning. This becomes, in other words, an artificial intelligence system. What will that bring to us? That will enable on-the-fly adaptations of, for example, the process settings to minimize the scrap and automatically reduce the conversion costs. This whole process will then happen autonomously. And that's why we call the line a digital composites manufacturing line. Let me show you some real pictures of the line as it is implemented. So you see here two pictures. You can recognize the uncoilers and the consolidation stations. Beckett is not very well seen, cannot be very well seen here, unfortunately. So what I want to mention also on this line is that we have successfully run with this line a production series of 5,000 laminates in single go, in 24/7 mode, by the way, with a line availability of more than 85%, which is excellent for such a demo line implemented from scratch. It's quite some new technologies that are introduced. This is quite nice. Let me show you a video, by the way, so that you can see the line running. Hopefully it will run. Yes.
This technology is really giving us the ability to make things on a large scale. This is really the first time that you can make this in a continuous fashion, and therefore again giving you more affordable parts that we can ship, of course, to our customer and provide the benefit to them.
It runs fully automatic and reduces cycle time drastically.
It's fully digital, so that means it's also very flexible. The efficiency is very high. We control all the parameters in the process and have full quality inspection, both of the tape that goes in and of the product that goes out.
Our customers will see, of course, parts with a much higher quality. It's going to be much more affordable to them. And of course, it can open up markets and applications to them that they currently do not have access to.
Hopefully you could recognize the trace for the layup system moving on the transport belt. The digital composites manufacturing line is very nicely combining and demonstrating the features that are required for a mass manufacturing line for thermoplastic composites. Just to mention, like 100% inspection at this capability we have implemented at the incoming and outgoing products. Also, the line has demonstrated a very high throughput capability. We have seen the feasibility for multi-million parts per year throughput capacity. Further, the line has reached a very high level of flexibility with the ability to adapt the size, for example, and lay up with press on a button. And it's a modular design, allowing plugging and new options or unplugging some of those. And it is fully digital. And it allows cloud-based data storage and analysis. And it has a central control system. There is a single computer who is controlling the whole process. So this generates quite significant capabilities. And these capabilities can even be extended further in a stepwise approach towards a fully integrated digital line with backward and forward integration of the systems like tape inspection and laminate inspection. For thermoplastic composites, scrap reduction tends to become a major concern, by the way. And it's also important to know that not all scrap is equal. We have scrap and we have scrap. And identification of the class of defects is key for determining what is okay, what is not okay, or what is healable or repairable. With, for example, process adaptations. Also, the digital twin will be possible with such a concept. If you don't have these capabilities, the digital twin will also not be possible. And the ultimate target will be, at the end, to go for an adaptive manufacturing line connecting all pieces with a digital twin and with artificial intelligence capabilities. Such a system could, for example, allow reduction of scrap by intelligent handling of defects. For example, a piece of tape with surface defect could be fed inside the layer without any feasible defects at the laminate level. At the consolidation stage, for example, we could automatically adapt the process settings on the fly to depending on the incoming material quality to enable better quality or acceptable quality laminates through the processing parameters. You can, for example, increase temperatures or pressures or whatever. At the end of the line, then you might think that we are done. No, we get laminates and they can still have some defects or flaws, which can be corrected somehow. For example, you can take those out of spec laminates and you can introduce there an equipment that can heal some of the defects and make the laminates which are going to the scrap box, you can recover them and you can put them into the okay box. This will, of course, has a tremendous impact on the total cost of the conversion. Well, finally, I would like to mention that our demo line was a finalist of Jack Wald Innovation Awards in 2019. And because of all the things that I have mentioned earlier and listed here again, flexibility, quality securing, digitalization, low scrap, and the potential applications scope that can be served with such a system. That brings me to the end of my story and presentation. And thank you very much for your attention.
Okay, so there is this question from the Azam. In the final production, in the final product, what could be the error of the digital composite line? How about errors of the digital composite line in case of the final productions?
Yeah, thank you for the question. I have The question is not fully clear for me. I will try to understand, explain it. So what I understand from the question is, what are the potential errors of the composites line? So where it can fail? You have multiple stages of the line. So you have quality inspection, you have consolidation, you have a layup, and the most critical part is normally the layup piece, where you have to deal with a different number of layers, and you have to secure a correct layup and correct sizing, and you need to make them very nicely fitting into tolerances. I think that could be an answer that I can give. For the rest, the question is not fully clear for me. Yeah, I'm sorry.
Let me move to the second question. Based on the data that you are collecting, can you control the tape properties? For example, the evenness of the fiber distribution, there is this recent rich region, poor faces that also have the implication on the consolidation in the following steps. So can you control the tape properties, for example?
As I mentioned, you have an incoming tape quality that is determined by the quality of the tape from supply. So that is something given. You cannot change it. It is coming as it is coming. And the only thing that you can do is, as I mentioned, using some artificial intelligence metrics to detect defects and see whether you can minimize scrap by intelligent handling of those defects, for example, putting in the middle, or you can have some possibilities to heal some of the defects. For example, if you have a dry spot, you can maybe spray some fluid resin on it to make it, to wet the fibers there. So that could be a possibility correcting the quality of the incoming tape.
Yeah, probably just one more question. It's a very short question. Is this line commercialized already?
This line is implemented, and so far I know Airborne is using it for their projects. And I am not fully aware of the current usage, but the line is definitely has receiving interest also from aerospace industry. So from Airbus, there was a delegation visiting us at the JEC stand as well, a booth, and so I'm not fully aware, but that there are certain interests, so I'm sure that the line is being used for multiple proposals.
Yeah, maybe I'll just simply add one comment to that if folks are interested, they can go on LinkedIn, and Airborne routinely runs actually webinars, and they do focus on this line as well, so you can join these free webinars.
Okay, when will be the webinar?
I don't know the latest one, Arif, but if you go and just type in Airborne, you will see that Mark Kramers, their CTO, is very active with these webinars and interviews with leading, I would say, cutting edge composite people. You know, like he did a very nice interview with the Aris Composites out of California recently, additive manufacturing people. So he's very active, and one of the things is demonstrating these lines. They have.
Excellent.